Dear students, welcome to my channel. In our operating system tutorial, today we will discuss introduction to thread. As you know, thread is a lightweight process. Our process consists of many threads. So myself, Niladri Shekhar Pal, I am working as an assistant professor at Computer Science and Engineering Department at Greater Kolkata College of Engineering. So what is thread? A thread basically a lightweight process. It is the basic unit of CPU execution. And it consists of many things like thread ID, program counter, set of registers to hold the information of current working variables, and stack, which includes the history of execution. Basically, thread ID for identifying the thread. Okay. Actually, a process consists of many number of threads. Okay, so to identify the thread, we use thread ID, and the program counter is used for to identify which thread will run next. Okay, and the set of registers is basically the information. Okay, of the variable which are working with the associated with the thread. Next, a thread shares same information, okay, to its associated thread, and the information consists of open files, the data segments and code segments. Okay, so it share, all the threads share same information, okay, which are associated, like open files, data segments, code segments, etc. If a thread changes a code segment memory item, then the other thread can see the changes in the thread. Suppose there are four threads are working in a process. Suppose there is a change in a single thread. Okay, so you can get or you can see the other changes in other three threads also. In other words, a thread is defined as a flow of execution via a process code. Okay, so it is defined as a flow of execution. Via the process thread improves the performance of applications with the help of parallelism, because threads are executed in parallel manner. Okay, so it improves the process speed or execution speed. As you know that the process consists of many threads and all the threads are working as parallel manner. Okay, so though it is working as a parallel manner, so the execution of the process becomes faster. Next, every thread is related to a single process, and without process, thread cannot exist. As I told before that, all the threads are associated with process. Okay, a process consists of many lightweight threads. Every thread shows a distinct flow of control. Okay. So, as I told that a process consists of multiple threads and each thread has its own working culture, okay? And threads are used in implementing web servers and network servers also. Parallel execution of the application is applicable in thread, which can be shared among the memory multiprocessors, okay? And therefore, next, working of a single thread and a multi-thread process, okay? So, in our picture, okay, we can see that there are two pictures are there. One is single process thread and another is single process multiple thread. Okay, there are three threads in my right hand picture. Okay, in this picture you can see that there are three threads. Okay, and for the three threads there are different codes are there, but all the threads are working on the same data and same files. And for each thread there are different register, counter and stack. Okay. So there are three threads in this process and all the threads have different codes, and for each thread there are different registers, counter and stack. Okay, so as you can see, the first thread there are three different register, counter and stack, and for second thread there are also different register, counter, stack, and for third thread also there are different register, counter and stack. But for all the three threads there are the same data and files. Okay, and this is the single thread process, single thread. Okay, as you can see, single thread has a single code, single data, single files, a single register, counter, right? So what is the difference between process and check? Basically, a process can be defined as a program in execution. Okay, when actually basically a program is within the secondary memory. Okay, so but a program is on an execution executable state. Okay, then it is called a process. But a thread can be defined as the flow of execution via the process code. Okay. In the process, switching requires interaction with the operating system. But in case of thread, in thread switching, there is no requirement to interact with the operating system. Next, in point 3, it is a heavyweight. Okay. And in case of thread, it is a lightweight process. In point 4, the process consumes more resources. So process needs more resources. Okay. But thread consumes fewer resources. Context switching requires more time in process. Okay. So context switching is possible in case of process and it requires more spaces. But in thread, context switching requires less time. Okay. The process needs more time for termination. Okay. The process actually what happens, a process consists of many lightweight threads. Okay. So when a process needs more time than thread, as you know that a process consists of many threads, so at first all the threads have to complete their execution. Okay, so that we can say that the process has completed. So as I told, the thread takes less time for termination as the thread is smaller than process, and the process takes more time for creation, but the thread takes less time for creation. Okay, so as process is much more bigger than thread, okay, so it takes more time for creation. So I'm again repeating that a process basically can be defined as a program in execution, okay, but a thread can be defined as the flow of execution via the process code. Next point, in the process, switching requires interaction with operating system. In thread switching, there is no requirement to interact with the operating system. Process is a heavyweight, but thread is a lightweight. The process consumes more resources as it is bigger, but thread consumes fewer resources as it is smaller than process. Context switching requires more time in process. Okay? For switch context switching, it requires more time in this process. But context switching requires less time in case of thread. But in process, the needs more time for termination. But the thread takes less time for termination. The process takes more time for creation, but the thread takes less time for creation. Okay. So next come to the advantages of threads. Number one is better CPU utilization. Okay. So if multiple threads are existing in one process, they can be scheduled on different processes, which makes the process execution quicker. So as I told that process consists of multiple threads. Okay, so they can work simultaneously or parallelly. Okay, so the CPU utilization will be much more faster. Okay, so all the process executed faster. Next, increased throughput of the system. If a process is broken into different threads and each thread task is considered as one job, and the number of jobs done is increased per unit of time, thus the throughput of the system also increases. Okay. And the next point is communication. It is very important. In the thread, communication is quite simple. Why? Because each thread shares a common address space. Okay. But in the process, we use some specific communications method for communication between the processes. Next point is resource sharing. As resources can be shared easily between all threads within a process, such as data, files, and okay. Next point is responsiveness. When the process is broken into different threads, and if any file will finish its execution, the output of thread is returned instantly. Okay. So I am again saying what are the main things. What are the advantages of thread? First one is better CPU utilization. That means if multiple threads are existing in one process, okay? They can be scheduled on different processes, which make the process execution much faster, okay? So in case of thread, we execute the process much faster. Next point is increased throughput of the system. If a process is broken into different threads and each thread task is considered as one job and the number of jobs done is increased per unit of time, okay? So thus the throughput of the system also increases. Next point is communication. In the thread, communication is quite simple. Why? Because each thread shares a common address space. But the process, we use some specific communication methods for communication between the processes. Next one is resource sharing. Resource can be shared easily between all threads within a process, such as data, files, and code. Okay. Next one is responsiveness. When the process is broken into different threads, and if any file finished its execution, the output of the thread is returned instead. Okay, so students, this is all about threads. Okay, so in our next chapter, we will discuss what are the different life cycle of thread. I am requesting you to subscribe my channel by click the bell icon on your right hand side of the screen. Okay, by subscribing my channel, you will get all the notification of my video tutorial, or you can visit www.facebook.com/digitalclassroomnilanjipal, or you can like my page to get all the notification of my video tutorial. If you have any problem, you can mail me at nilanjipal86@gmail.com or can call me at my mobile number. Okay students, thank you. See you in my next video tutorial. Dear students, welcome to my channel. In our operating system tutorial section, today we will discuss different types of threads. Okay. In our previous tutorial, we have discussed what is thread, okay, how it works, what are the differences with processes and with threads, okay, and what are the advantages of threads. So today we will discuss different types of threads. Myself, Niladri Shekhar Pal. I am working as an assistant professor at Computer Science and Engineering Department at Greater Kolkata College of Engineering. So there are two types of threads. One is user level thread and another one is kernel level thread. Okay. There are two types of thread. First one is user level thread and second one is kernel level thread. So what is user level thread? Basically, user level threads are those type of thread that are created in the user level library. So it is created at the user level library. These user level threads are not implemented with the help of system calls. Okay. So in case of user level thread, there is no requirement or there is no intervention of system calls. Third one is, if we want to switch thread, then there is no need to interrupt the kernel and call operating system. So in case of user level thread, okay, if we want to switch thread, then there is no need to interrupt the kernel, okay, and call operating system. Next one, in the user level thread, there is no need for the kernel to know about the user level thread and handle threads if a process containing a single thread, okay. So in case of user level thread, if there is a single thread, okay, so there is no need for intervention of kernel, okay, to know about any user level thread or to handle that thread. Next one, the examples of user level threads are POSIX threads, Java threads, okay. These are all the user level threads. So you can see the picture of user level thread, okay. So this is the user space. You can see the process P1, this is process 2, This is the thread library, okay, that is accessible by all the threads, okay, and this is also a thread library for process P2. All the threads within this P2 process will execute this library. This is the kernel space, okay, and this is the CPU. Next, what are the advantages of user level thread? User level thread is easy to create because in this there is no intervention of kernel, okay. So as there is no involvement of kernel, it is easy to create, okay. Next one is, it is fast because there is no need of operating system calls, okay. So operating system calls is not required in case of user level thread, okay. So it becomes much faster, as you know that operating system calls make the threads slower, okay. So user level thread don't use operating system calls, okay. So it becomes faster. Next one, it is easy to run a user level thread in any operating system, okay, as it don't have any intervention of kernel, it don't need any operating system calls, okay. So it is easy to run in operating system. And what are the disadvantages? If one thread page fault is caused, then the whole process is blocked, okay. So in case of user level thread, if a page fault occurred, okay, so then the whole process will be blocked. In the second one, the user level thread, there is no coordination between threads and the kernel, as we know that there is no involvement of kernel in case of user level thread, okay. So there is no coordination between threads and kernels, okay. Next, come to kernel level thread. Kernel level threads are those, okay, that are directly managed by the operating system, and the kernel does the management of the thread, okay. So it is directly managed by operating system. In this kernel level thread, rather creating a thread table for each process, kernel has its own table, okay, that is master table, that is used to keep track of all the threads in the system, okay. So in this kernel level thread, there is no thread table. Each kernel level thread has a master table, okay. So in this master table, all the threads are keep track, okay. We can using this table, all the threads can be tracked. It is also keeping track of the classical process table to maintain track of the process, okay. Next, the operating system kernel offers a system call to handle and implement a thread, okay. So we have seen that in case of user level thread, that system call is not intervened, okay. But in case of kernel level thread, system calls are used, okay. So it is become implementation of thread, it become easier. Example of kernel level thread is Windows Solaris, okay. Next, this is the pictorial representation of kernel level thread. As you can see that this is the process and this is the whole process, and these are all three threads, okay. There are three threads within the process. This is the another process, okay. This process also consists of four threads. This is the kernel, and this is the process table, and this is the thread table. And what are the advantages of kernel level thread? Kernel level threads is useful for applications that are block frequently, okay. Next, because the kernel has complete knowledge of the system threads, the scheduler may decide to give more time to those processes which have a different number of threads, okay. So I am repeating once again, because the kernel has complete knowledge of the system thread, the scheduler may decide to give more time to those processes which have a different number of threads. So as I have seen in my kernel level thread pictorial representation, that kernel process may have multiple threads of kernel level threads. So in case of kernel level threads, it can shows that which process has how many number of threads. So those processes are given much more time for execution which has made much number of threads, okay. So what are the disadvantages of kernel level thread? Number one is kernel level threads are slow, okay. So as it is complicated than user level threads, so it is much more complicated. Next one is kernel level threads are not efficient, okay. Third one is kernel level thread is overhead because it needs a thread control. Okay. It's much more difficult and complicated. Next come, what are the differences between user level thread and kernel level thread? Number one is the thread which is created with the help of a user is known as user level thread. And the thread which are created with the help of an operating system are known as kernel level. Next come, in the user level thread, the time of context switching is less. Okay. But in the kernel level thread, the time of context switching is much more than user level thread. The operating system cannot recognize the user level thread. Okay. But the operating system can recognize the kernel level thread. Next, the user level threads are implemented in an easy way. Okay. The kernel level threads are difficult to implement. So this is all about user different types of threads. Okay, so we have two types of thread. One is user level thread and kernel level thread. Okay, so in this tutorial we have discussed user level thread and kernel level thread. Okay, so in our next tutorial we will discuss another topic from operating system. So I am requesting you to subscribe my channel by clicking the bell icon on your right hand side. Okay, you will get all the notification of my tutorial. Or you can visit www.facebook.com/digitalclassroomnilanjanpant and like my page. Okay. You can, if you have any doubt, any query, you can mail me at nilanjanpant86@gmail.com. So students, thank you. See you in the next video. Dear students, welcome to my channel. In our operating system tutorial series, today we will learn multi-threading. Okay, so in our previous lecture, we have learned threading. Okay, so in this lecture, we will discuss about multi-threading. Myself, Niladri Shekhar Pal, I am working as an assistant professor at Computer Science and Engineering Department at Greater Kolkata College of Engineering and Management. So let's start multi-threading. So what is multi-threading? Multi-threading means using both types of threads, that is user level thread and kernel level thread. An example of multi-threading is Solaris. Multi-threading models can be classified into three types. First one is one-to-one model, second one is one-to-many model, and third one is many-to-many model. Okay, so let's discuss these three models. So first, one-to-one model. Basically, in one-to-one model, it is a multi-threading model in which one-to-one relationship exists between the kernel level thread and user level thread. So in one-to-one model, there is a relationship, okay, one-to-one relationship between kernel level thread and user level thread. Next, one-to-one models can run multiple threads on multiple processors, okay. So in one-to-one models, there are number of threads, okay, on multiple processors. So each processors have each thread, separate threads, okay. In one-to-one model, to create a user level thread, we also need a kernel level thread, okay. So this is a problem in one-to-one model, okay. So it is dependent on kernel level thread. So this is the pictorial representation of one-to-one model, okay. So as you can see that these are the kernel space, okay. So for each CPU, that is, I have already mentioned that for each processor there is individual kernel space, okay. So for there are multiple CPUs are there, and for them there are individual kernel spaces are available, okay. And here you can see that user spaces, there are thread library, okay. So each process has thread library, okay. So individual process has individual thread library, okay. So next, many to one model.
In many-to-one multi-threading model, many user threads are mapped to a single kernel. Okay. So what happened? In our previous one-to-one model, there are individual, individual thread for individual process. But in case of many-to-one model, many user threads are mapped into a single kernel level thread. Okay. If due to user thread, the system call is blocked. Okay. And then the whole process become blocked. In this, the task of thread management is managed by the thread library in the convenient user space. Okay. So this is the pictorial representation of many-to-one model. Okay. Here you can see that these are the CPUs. Okay. These are four CPUs you are there. There are kernel spaces. Okay. And there are process P1, process P2, okay. So these are the thread libraries, okay. So this is the process P1, this is thread library, this is process 2 thread library. Next go many to many model. In many to many multi-threading models, the user can create multiple threads, okay. And if the kernel system call is blocked, then the entire process does not block, okay. So the model multiplies multiple user level threads onto smaller, okay, or an equal number of kernel level threads. Next, in this process can be divided across multiple processors, okay. So processes can be divided to perform against different multiple processors, and this is the pictorial representation of many to many model, okay. So here you can see that process P1 are given to different kernel, okay. Process P2 also given to different kernels, okay. So different kernel spaces are performed different, okay. So many process has many kernel, okay. So what are the advantages of multi-threading? Basically, main advantages of multi-threading is context switching, okay. So context switching is an easy in multi-threading. We can easily perform context switching in multi-threading. Next, it is responsiveness, okay. So it responds very fast, okay. So my multi-threading has all the processes are worked simultaneously. So it is very much responsiveness. So it is very fast. Resource sharing is easy. So it offers better utilization of resources. So in case of multi-threading, resources are shared easily, okay. So resource sharing become very utilized. Next one is implementation and managing threads is quite simple, okay. So implementation of thread and manage those threads are quite easy. Next, what are the multi-threading issues, okay. So we have few issues. Number one is fork system call. What is fork system call? Fork is defined as a system call, okay, that is executed in the kernel. So fork is basically executed in the kernel. With the help of fork, we basically a copy of the process is created. So with the use of fork, we can create a copy of the process. Okay. So we can create a copy of process. Next, the issue in multi-threading is that when one thread forks, the whole process should be copied or not. Okay. So the issue in multi-threading is what? Is that when one thread forks, the whole process should be copied or not. Okay. Next, multi-threading issues, thread cancellation. Thread cancellation is another issue in multi-threading, in which the thread terminates before the thread completes its working. And we can use two approaches to perform this thread cancellation. Number is asynchronous cancellation and second one is deferred cancellation. So what is asynchronous cancellation? It basically terminates the destination thread. And what is deferred cancellation? Deferred cancellation is basically it checks the destination thread regularly if it should be cancelled or not. Okay. So it checks whether the destination thread regularly. Okay. So if it should be cancelled or not. Next is security. So security is another issue, okay, that arises in multi-threading. Because in multi-threading, resources are shared extensively among multiple threads. So it is in multi-threading what's happened, resources are basically shared by multiple threads. Okay. So there is a chances of security threat. Okay. So this is easily handled by multi-threading. And next one is signal handling. Okay. So in Unix system, as we know, signals are used to alert a process. Okay. That there has been a particular event. So student, this is about multiple threading. Okay. So we have understand what is multi-threading. Okay. What are the advantages of multi-threading? How many types of multi-threading are there? Okay, what are the issues of multi-threading? Okay, so if you have any doubt, any query, you can write on the comment section, or you can like my YouTube channel or subscribe my channel. Okay, and if you want to visit www.facebook.com/digitalclassroomilajipal and like my page. Okay, students. So if you have any query, you can also mail me at nilajipal86@gmail.com. So student, thank you for now. See you in the next tutorial.